morning, everybody, and welcome. I'm Margaret Miller. I'm the director of the Institute for Research in Art, and I'm hoping more people come. But let me talk a little bit about our efforts to reach out across campus and engage faculty and students from all disciplines in our programming. This is one of those efforts, this colloquium today. We have others coming up and some that have already taken place that are related to the current exhibition, The Talent Show, never mind, that's all right, that was the talent show that is currently on display at the Contemporary Art Museum and comes to us from the Walker Art Center. I've given everybody, I think, a brochure that's just been printed, kind of outlining and giving you a description of the show in general, but also short paragraphs on several of the projects or specific pieces in the exhibition. So this is our first event related to the exhibition following the opening was on October 6th, and it was See and Be Seen, and it was a spotlight portrait night related to actually an artist that will be discussed today, David Lamalis's piece. And students were invited to come in and stand under the spotlight with supposedly this fog or haze surrounding them, and the viewer was more or less the participant viewer was put on the spot and maybe asked to perform, or at least maybe there was a slight discomfort in being in the spotlight. And that's really illustrates, I think, some of the themes that are so challenging and provocative about this exhibition. So we're trying to convey to the broader faculty, student, community audiences as much as we can about the nature of this exhibition. It's not an easy exhibition, but they're terrific wall labels. The show actually comes to us from the Walker Art Center in Minneapolis and toured to Seattle. And during that tenure of the exhibition in Seattle, they actually developed a number of education programs and wall labels that we also are using in our exhibition. So coming up on November,
November 2nd?
On November 2nd will be the Intervenus tapes, a piece by Hannah Wilkie, who suffered from cancer and developed multiple screen videos of all documenting this horrific battle with this disease. It's a terribly moving piece. And Megan Bowler, who's working as a postgraduate fellow with us this semester, has organized another colloquium based on that piece. And it's going to be, Megan, correct me if I'm wrong, but have you scheduled it now for the School of Music's new building, the conference center there? And what time will that be?
It's at 7 p.m.
So I hope you'll join us for that, because it'll be a very different kind of conversation, but I think equally challenging and provocative. And then the very next day, there'll be a gallery talk and a series we're doing on Thursday evenings, a talk with our new curator, Jane Simon, and she's going to talk about Chris Burden. She actually wrote her master's degree thesis on Chris Burden and is quite an expert on it. And we have three pieces by Chris Burden in the exhibition. And by the way, he's profiled quite significantly in the current issue of Art Forum magazine, if you follow that magazine, because so much is being made at the moment of long history of artwork produced in Los Angeles. And he was, of course, part of that scene as a performance artist. So you have that to look forward to on November 3rd, and then on November 18th, Megan Bowler is working to organize a performance parade. I think it's called the Magic Base Parade. Mm-hmm. And it will start at the Contemporary Art Museum and move across campus, and she's lining up performers. And this is based on a base that Piero Manzoni created in 1961. And Tony and staff, I guess, are making our own version of it. So you'll actually be able to witness and perform as the Magic Base tours specifically designated sites across campus, and we're doing what we can with social media to try to get followers of this parade. So these are all efforts to try to communicate as much as we can about the nature of our exhibitions, but in specifically now the talent show. So I really ask you to please participate and encourage your students, because this is all being done for the campus, and if we don't have participants, then we fail. So give us ideas about how we can get the word out, how we can make these projects a little more engaging for the students. It's my pleasure today to introduce to you Noelle Smith. Most of you in this room know her well. Noelle has been a remarkable contributor to our understanding of what's going on in Latin American art, most specifically Cuba. She is our curator of Latin American and Caribbean art. She's also our curator of education, and she wears a third hat, which is the director of the Museum Studies Program. Her office is over at Graphic Studio, but her work with the Institute for Research in Art, which includes the Contemporary Art Museum, Graphic Studio, and the Public Art Program, her expertise moves through all of those programs. She's worked to curate several exhibitions, remarkable exhibitions for us, and her partner has often been Karina Matamoros, who is the curator of Cuban art at the National Museum of Fine Arts in Havana. And we really took on a very quick and major undertaking in 2005 with the Los Carpinteros, curated an exhibition and produced an amazing catalog called Inventing the World. And then in 2007, she again worked with Karina Matamoros to produce Homing Devices, 2007. And now most recently, working with Karina again on Carlos Garacoa's exhibition, Making Amends, which just closed at the Cornell Museum, the Johnson Museum at Cornell. So she was acting director for a short period of time of the USF Institute for Study of Latin America and the Caribbean. I'm sure they benefited from her tenure as acting director, but it was our loss at the Institute for Research in Art, and I'm glad she's continuing with us. Her expertise and relationships with Cuba have been an extremely important component, and more broadly with Latin America, for the Institute. And we brought many artists, some of which I just mentioned, Carlos Garacoa and Los Carpinteros, to produce work at Graphic Studio. So I'm turning this over to Noelle Smith, who will introduce our participants and say a few words about how the subject of today's colloquium fits with the talent show.
Well, thank you, Margaret. I'd like to begin by thanking all the faculty and staff at the Institute for Research in Art for their assistance with this project. The School of Art and Art History, and I'd like to thank Special Collections and Florence Gendro for hosting us. There's a large number of faculty, staff, and students at USF who are involved in Latin American studies across all the disciplines, but we seldom have an opportunity to gather and share our research with each other and with the larger community. So when I saw that the talent show had the work of two distinguished Latin American, South American artists, David Lamelas and Graciela Carnevale, the idea for this panel immediately suggested itself. So I'm very grateful to my colleagues for their enthusiasm at the idea, their excellent scholarship, hard work, and readiness to embrace this opportunity and in making this encounter a reality. The work of Luis Kapnitzer, who's essayist, artist, and critic, and professor emeritus of art at SUNY Old Westbury, provides the touchstone for our discussions today. In his 2007 text, Conceptualism in Latin American Art, Didactics of Liberation, he writes, and I quote, "What I'm trying to do here is to trace the roots and genealogies of Latin American conceptualism from its own tradition, rather than treating it like a derivative product of what was current in New York and Paris, often many years later." Of course, he refers to conceptual art. And an analysis comparing North American and European-based conceptual art and Latin American conceptualism is compelling and could involve many discussions, including center and periphery, the writing of art history, formalist concerns, among other important issues. But more to the point today, to our attentions, is an examination of some of the histories, contexts, and strategies that gave birth to and shaped what we call Latin American conceptualism, and a look at its legacy for today's contemporary artists and art. We begin today with Vanessa Diaz, who will be discussing the talent show exhibition with the emphasis on Carnavale and Lamelas. Historian Adriana Novoa will follow with a discussion of Luis Chemnitzer's analysis of Latin American conceptualism, its relation to the exhibition and other Latin American works. And she will emphasize the importance of local context in this conceptualism and its relation to history. Pablo Brescia of World Languages will look at the references to the Argentine writer, essayist, poet, and translator Jorge Luis Borges by Latin American artists and in the work of Chemnitzer, and talk a little bit about the literary scene and Borges' production. And last but not least, Cesar Cornejo will discuss the legacy of Latin American conceptualism and the subsequent career of David Lamelas and his own work. So we'll have questions at the end. So if you'd like to keep your questions and comments for the end, that would be great. And what I'm gonna do is I'm going to introduce each panelist as we go along. So of course I forgot my bios here. I'm really pleased to introduce Vanessa Diaz. She's an interdisciplinary artist working with methods of sculpture, installation, fibers, and painting. She's a graduate student in her second year of the MFA program at USF. She earned her BFA with concentration in painting and a BA in art history from Florida Atlantic University. Recently, she participated in a summer internship at the Atlantic Center for the Arts in New Smyrna Beach, and has been accepted to attend a residency at the Vermont Studio Center during the month of February 2012. I met Vanessa when she came to me with her interest in Cuban art, so we definitely share that. And she's also been working with me this semester on a directed study, and this presentation today is part of that work. Thank you. Please welcome Vanessa.
So I'm going to start by giving a brief overview of the talent show exhibition and then focus on the two artists from Argentina. The talent show exhibition explores competing desires of notoriety and privacy.
Could you just like move that mic a little? You're very tall.
Yes, I'll move it towards me.
Thank you.
Okay. Competing desires of notoriety and privacy and the evolving relationship between artists, audiences, and in our culture of reality TV and web-based social media. For almost half a century, artists have modeled and exhibited these desires and dramatized the complex dynamics that surround them, often engaging people to participate in their work with and without their knowledge. The exhibition draws on found objects in its mix of images and sculptures, including the found behavior of people who on video or in photographs come under the camera's scrutiny. And this first image I'm showing is by artist Amy Siegel. It's called Gotta Go My Own Way. And this artist compiles and edits together YouTube videos of different teenage girls singing this song. And I think that this piece demonstrates a direct influence on television and American Idol and the current generation. It's also a comment on the current generation's desire for fame and for notoriety and for replicating and mimicking behaviors of celebrities, and possibly the redundancy of poses and expressions in music videos that are seen in popular culture. In addition to Facebook and the idea of creating a marketable image of oneself and sharing with others these conflicting levels of privacy that are involved in social media. The next image by Hannah Wilk, intravenous tapes from 1990 to 1993. As Margaret had mentioned it before, it's a 16-channel video installation which was produced after her death from lymphoma, and which during the 2.5 period of her illness, she had documented over 30 hours of footage. And this piece explores the space between our private lives and what one chooses to expose, and raises questions about what is gained by exposure like this. Exposing these raw, intimate moments in one's life, and exposing these raw, intimate moments in one's life, and why this type of reality is often censored or considered just private, but this fictional, edited reality, for instance, with the YouTube videos of the girls singing, the edited reality and mimic packaged behavior of celebrities is everywhere, whereas something like this is considered very personal. And society may be wanting more of the same, more of celebrities, and more of mimicking behavior. And even with this installation, where it's her life and it's her private, it's an intimate look into her life, this is still edited. So it comments on how even documentary is somewhat structured for the viewer. In this exhibition, so many of the works are about the process of developing the idea, and in some instances, how viewer participation was involved. And reading about the process in the title and in the description of the artworks is a very important element into understanding the pieces. This piece by Gillian Waring, Signs That Say What You Want Them to Say, and Signs That Say What Someone Else Wants You to Say, from 1992 to 1993. The sign on the left, on your right, says, I have been certified mildly insane, and on the left, you can probably see it, says, I'm desperate. By giving the people in these images an opportunity to say what they want, the artist invited her subjects to directly participate in creating their own image and to further influence the viewer as to how the image will be understood. And this piece by Piero Manzoni, Base Magica, or Scultura Viviente, Living Sculpture, 1961, is a piece that brings the viewer's participation into the real time of the exhibition space, where the viewer actually stands on this pedestal and becomes a piece of living art. They're elevated almost to the status of art. And there are several pieces in the show that involve this type of immediate viewer participation. And this next one by David Lamelas is one of the Argentinian artists that we're representing. And he makes work about the ways in which information is imported to us through media and the ways in which we receive it. He analyzes how the mediums of photography, television, and film analyze information, or fictionalize information. And this piece titled Limit of a Projection from 1967 involves direct audience participation. And it's a single theatrical spotlight which creates an intriguing space for the viewer to stand underneath, which could possibly bring up this desire to act out or perform, and could also bring upon this feeling that you're being watched, and a pressure of attention regardless of others being in the room, regardless of someone being present. The next piece is titled, also by Lamelas, is Situation di Tempo, from 1967. It consisted of 17 television sets that were donated by a large electronic company that was associated with the gallery that this work was presented in. All the sets were turned on to non-existent channels, so there was no reception, and there was no information. They were only an abstract provider of light. Lamelas was interested in the importance of the technological object as an icon and its capacity to modify the environment and how the presence of technology became dominant in this space. This piece not only commented on the icon of communication media, but the corporate sponsor's technological contribution of all the televisions, and then the piece became a reflection of changes occurring within public cultural institutions, and began to anticipate an era of corporate culture sponsorship within these public institutions. The next piece, titled Dos Espacios Modificados, made for the 1967 Sao Paulo Biennial, is a structure that repeats the architecture of the exhibition space and transforms the space into different ways of relating to the exhibition situation and the expectations of where and how art should be displayed and what is art. And it gave the spectator an invitation to analyze the circumstances and the restricted space that allowed an artist to exhibit art in. It framed an area that was given to the artist, represented in the Argentina Biennial. And this piece transformed the use of the building, and it was a critique on the institutional space and the restrictions of traditional art viewing experiences. And the next year, after Lamelas had made this piece, he was 20 years old when he made this piece, and the next year he represented Argentina in the Venice Biennial, and after that he had moved to London to continue his master's degree. Several years later, he had made a piece in Dusseldorf titled Time as an Activity, and it was actually, I have only two images here, but it's actually, I couldn't find the third one, but it's three video feeds, but they were film, it was 16 millimeter film, and they were taken in static takes of 4 minutes each at three central locations in the city of Dusseldorf. And the gallery context for this piece was critical for Lamelas, and a quote from him: "In those days, you usually went to a museum auditorium to see a film. My idea was to show both the film and the projector. It worked like a time projector, projecting another time than the real time. The projector becomes the object that projects the image, the distance between the projector and the surface, and the light between both. So it was not just a film, it was a whole environment." He saw the device as part of the installation, the light coming from the device that touched the wall as part of it, and the entire space in the room as key elements to understanding how and where image came from, and for the viewer to have a sensory experience of the entire space. This comments on our knowledge and the projected situation. Our knowledge of how the projected situation is inevitably fractured, and our understanding is incomplete because elements of the process of projecting, like the equipment, is hidden. So, as I said, he exposed this process and created an environment with the device. The next piece is titled Rockstar from 1974. And this is an image of Lamelas, who wanted to use an element that represented pop culture. So by playing the role of a rock star, he represented a stereotyped poses and a cliche of a musician in ecstasy. He commented on how photography and documentary crossed so quickly into fiction, and the phenomenon of stardom and how media is manipulated. And this goes back to influencing Amy Siegel's piece with YouTube's videos, where teenage girls are mimicking behaviors and feel like they're rock stars in a sense. And today this is so common that rock stars are produced through their image only and marketability. And it's common that we maybe see rock stars before we hear them. Or pop stars. You see images before you hear their music and popular culture. And this is a slide. These are six still images of a film titled The Desert People. And this was made when David Lamelas moved to Los Angeles. And these are film stills from a fictional film in documentary style, which highlighted the lack of information used in documentaries to convey truth and the process of editing. It was also a study on the American film industry. But Lamellis is exploring what he sees as the impossibility of one culture to understand another. And I showed this image to demonstrate Lamellis making work in different countries and his exposure to other cultures and how his experience of relocation continually influenced his work and his ways of understanding information, and how location and place were primary in his work, and he interrogates the modes in which we see and represent the world and how we define what is real. He reminds us that media and institutions constantly manipulate our viewpoints, and that it is no longer easy to separate reality from fiction. His work challenges us to take distance and to question the role of media. Now I'm showing a duplicate slide of what Lamellis was doing in Argentina in 1967, because it will lead me to discussing Graciela Carnevale and what she was doing in Argentina in 1968. Carnevale was part of a group of artists from Rosario, Argentina, who were looking for other definitions of art and roles for artists. Because they began to realize that traditional resources and institutions were obsolete and they were not effective ways of communicating ideas, that art was being directed towards a small percentage of society, and that they wanted to challenge the institution that controlled what was considered to be art. This piece is part of the Cycle of Experimental Art, which was a series of exhibitions organized by this group. It is entitled En Serio y Escaping, Entrapment and Escape, from 1968. It was held in a storefront gallery space in the city, and she had put posters to cover the windows to block the view from the inside and out. And in the gallery space, it was empty. There was no work. Viewers came thinking that they were going to possibly see artwork, but there were no traditional art objects inside the space. And what she had done when she had brought people into the gallery, soon after, she had snuck out. And this is an image of her leaving the gallery space and proceeding to lock the viewers inside. So what ended up happening was that the viewers became the material of the artwork. And it was a comment on, it was the material, it's a social artwork. And they ended up trying to pick the lock and to get out. They tore down the paper. And then as time grew and they became more agitated, someone eventually from the outside, after about an hour, broke the glass window and let them out. This is them inside. This is them coming out. And the piece commented on passively submitting to all degrees of violence, from the most subtle and degrading, that coerces our thinking through media communications, and how through acts of aggression, the work provokes the spectator to a heightened level of consciousness to regard the violence taking place every day and their vulnerability in certain spaces. And at the same time, Carnevale was also a part of a project called Tu Comme en Art, or Tu Comme en is Burning. And this was an example of art fully going into the political arena. They used an experimental process of information analysis, multimedia reportage, and artistic display in an attempt to expose exploitation and impoverishment in the Tucumcamo province. And this province was one of the biggest sugar producing regions in Argentina and had very low levels of literacy, infant mortality, and children who remained in school. And the group questioned the role of art in society and the responsibilities of an artist as an active member of the social system. This forced a review of the artistic practice, and
these are some of the issues that they agreed upon. To not show work into galleries and museums, not restricting work to an elite public, and to challenge society and achieve results similar to a political action. So there were over 20 artists working on this project, in which the final exhibition was to take place at the Confederation General de los Trabajadores Trade Union in Rosario. They emphasized sensory experience that could produce knowledge, utilizing photographs as evidence of poverty, and the visitors' immersion into an environment packed with visual and textual stimuli. The concept of over-information they wanted to generate, an environment that would spread the idea of revolution to those who were present and immerse them in that. And this is part of the, these are some images from the show and part of the immersion of the viewers. The show was shut down after 2 weeks, and many of the participating artists had stopped making art for a while because they couldn't go back to traditional forms of art making and exhibiting. It's almost as if they had crossed this boundary of what art could be, and it was more than objects presented in a controlled environment, that it was art about concept, about change, about progressively influencing society. And in this final slide is an example of the relics of Tucumán art being displayed in a gallery museum setting, because that's still where the public goes to see art. And this was a way of, in Carnaval's comment, this is a way of exhibiting these records to enable a broader public to become aware of these experiences from the 60s and to continue to address the critical attitude towards the system and its institutions, to further bring debate as to the meaning of art in society and how the market structures and controls ways of creating art. She states that Tucumán art was an action directly related to a context and to its place and time, and that it cannot be recreated. And it was so important to the location, and this is a way of exposing some of the history of the event. I think that many of the pieces in the talent show exhibition, although are not as politically influenced, are focused on documentation as evidence and the idea of, focus on documentation as evidence of an idea developing, and the importance of viewer participation and how participation relates to that idea. And in seeing the show and the variety of pieces and how the artists use the idea of participation to engage the viewer in different ways, I think a greater understanding of artists breaking the limits of art and the restrictions of what is considered art is expanded. Thank you.
Graduate work she did at the Instituto di Tella under the supervision of Torquato di Tella before going to the University of California, San Diego, where she completed her MA and PhD in Latin American history. She is a cultural historian whose specialty is science in Latin America, and with Alex Levine, she has written a book about Darwinism in Argentina entitled From Man to Monkey, which is forthcoming from the University of Chicago Press. She is currently completing another manuscript on this topic, which treats the politics of evolutionism and its relationship to gender and race. Unclaimed Fright, Race, Masculinity, and National Identity in Argentina, 1850 to 1910. And she's also in the process of researching a new project about the cultural history of the idea of disappearance in Argentina. Dr. Novoa's articles have been published in Journal of Latin American Studies, Science and Context, the Latino Americanist, and Revista Hispanica Moderna, among others. Her classes deal with cultural conflict and identity formation in post-independence Latin America. Please welcome Adriana.
Okay, first, I would like to express my gratitude to Manuel Smith for the invitation to present here today. As everybody knows and Margaret mentions, she has been a wonderful benefactor for those of us who teach and research on cultural expression in Latin America. And this colloquium is another example of her generosity and her interest in advancing the knowledge of our area of studies at USF, so I'm always grateful to her. And second, I would like to express also my gratitude to the other panelists whose work I respect and admire very much. It's a pleasure for me to be here. After Noel's invitation, I spent quite a bit of time trying to decide the content of my talk. As a cultural historian with some artistic aspirations, I feel poorly qualified to define conceptualism in Latin America in front of other experts. So I decided to analyze the way in which one of the most important conceptualist artists of the area defined his approximation to art. Luis Caminitzer, born in 1937 in Germany, but moved to Uruguay, was raised in Uruguay, in fact, is an artist that currently resides in the United States, but was an active participant of the things that Vanessa just mentioned to you. Even when he was from Uruguay, there was very much contact among the artists from Latin America. All participating in this type of discussions about the meaning of art in the 60s. His impression and crucial role in the development of conceptualism made him a great case study to understand this type of artistic expression as different from the way in which it developed in the United States or in Europe, by that matter. So I would like to center my talk around his ideas relating those differences. I would like to emphasize that, as the same Caminitzer recognizes, Latin American culture, and in the sense, of course, also art, is the result of a process of synthesis that it might that is not related as is not developed as a result of a formalist opposition of previous styles. For most artists of the 20th century avant-garde, the lack of a modern tradition allows the embrace of a synthetic process that could assimilate different traditions and timescales without a preoccupation for the notion of continuity or discontinuity. That's probably when she presented me, you didn't understand why a person who's a scientist and, you know, early 20th century has any interest in art. But I'm interested in Latin American thought, and Latin American art expressed that same interest in synthesis and the discussion of tradition, which is quite distinct from other movements, as in the case in the United States and Europe. Diverse ideas from different places arrived, and they were assimilated in a process that responded to present needs and not to oppositional formal content. The claim to universality is used not in the sense that all cultures are or should be the same, but attributing to art an openness that comes from creating possibilities. An artist in Europe or the United States plays him or herself in the context of what has been previously done and the continuation of the structure of work. In Latin America, modern expression is associated with an emptiness that is not connected with the past, but with creation of the future. As I always explain to my students, while the avant-garde movements in Europe create an interest in otherness and the same construction of this concept, in Latin American art, the avant-garde allowed the return to the self through the other. So being other turned out to be, for the first time, an opportunity to discuss the local and its relationship with otherness itself. It is for this reason that we can see that in these very strange pairings in the work of artists in Latin America, and it's very common that you see a deep questioning of the same meaning of locality and self in these works. I would like, for those of you who are not experienced with this, to mention two examples that address this issue. Caminitzer mentions the important connection that existed between conceptualist strategies and social realism, in the sense that there is not a concern for the essence of art in social realism, and and intentions in this respect, I removed from those in conceptual art, I'm closer to those in Latin American conceptualism. End of quote. The critic Maricarmen Ramirez established a continuum from the work of the Mexican muralists after the Mexican Revolution that started in 1910, with a ready maze of Duchamp, which might be an odd connection for some. But according to her, in Latin America, the use of ready maze to communicate ideas, and I quote, point to an underlying concern with evaluation, the loss of this object's symbolic value as a result of any economic or ideological process of exchange, as opposite to North American artists preoccupied with the process of commodification. Those, the acts of reinsertion carried out by these artists are intended to reinvest objects with social meaning, end of the quote. It is for this reason that Duchamp gave permission to these artists to use whatever they wanted to use to communicate her, himself, beyond the act of artistic production. In the same way, according to Ramirez, the muralists eliminate the notion of artistic autonomy to emphasize the importance of political communication. Moving to the 60s, and I'm very grateful that you brought the pictures, things I will mention, because as historians, we don't have a lot of luck trying to present images. So I'm happy that you already see the part of the works I will mention now. Moving to the 60s, a crucial time for Kaminitzer, he explained that the emergence of conceptualism tried to balance, and I quote, the conundrum of individual contemplation versus collective education, end of the quote. The latter, being related with muralism, implied the complete politicization of art. According to him, and I quote, resignification and contextualization were interesting tools because they allow artists to deal with content, especially political content, without having to engage in storytelling, and those run the risk of degenerating into illustration. End of the quote. While before this decade, political art was related to content and the art object could not be political action because then it will erase, it would cease to exist as art, the art of the 60s was associated with political action, not with illustration of politics. So instead of, you know, making posters, was very much related with the forms in which the artist could engage in political transformation of society. Kaminitzer gives three markers for the conceptualism that emerged in Latin America. First, the elimination of visuality in order to enhance context, which is part of what Vanessa mentioned. Second, linguistic mapping in order to focus on content of the message. Third, spatialization of language in order to focus on content and its invocations. It is precisely in the different perspectives of the use and role of language that the differences between Latin American conceptualism and mainstream conceptualism lies. According to him, according to Mitzer, in conceptualism, I quote, language can be viewed as a constituent part of a complex system that has the power to serve as a tool of analysis of that system, or it can serve as a vehicle for altering the system by creating new forms of consciousness in tension with the existing system. Poetry falls into the second category, and it is that dimension that language became critical to Latin American conceptualism. End of the quote, and Pablo, I imagine, will deal with this. It is for this reason that he, Kaminitzer, sees an important difference between conceptualism developed in the United States and in Latin America. In order to demonstrate this, he points out that even when dematerialization and textualization are important in both, in Latin America there are four areas of difference. First, the function of dematerialization. Second, the role of pedagogy. Third, the use of text. And four, the literary analog used as a model of art. Another point that Pablo will discuss. The process of dematerialization in Latin America was not related with formalist speculation as it is in other places. It is part of political expression, easy to access and cheap, all important considerations in the 60s. The materialization then responded to ideological, practical, and economical reasons. In 1966, the Argentine critic of Carma Sota, which was the most important critic at the time and incredibly influential not only in Argentina but in other places, introduced the term dematerialization, taken, according to some, from an article for the New Left Review. view that said, and I quote, "The idea that moves the masses today is materialism. However, it is the materialization that characterized the times," end of the quote. Masota was a participant in an anti-happening that was very remarkable at the time, that consisted in the creation of an event that never happened in real life. And this is connected to what you just mentioned in terms of the use of documentaries and media. So, but the event never happened, but this was discussed in the press. And the newspapers wrote the comment about this event that in fact never happened. And they make the information of the piece itself, which was of course very much the discussion that occurred at the time. Where was the art? By the way, this was done in one of the most incredible bloody dictatorships. So producing this art was actually very unsafe. And the context that they want to address was precisely that. I mean, the limits of art in society that was so traumatized by violence, which you mentioned, for example, in Tucumán-Arte. Since Masota was the most important critic, and through this materialization was criticizing pop art and its objects, there were many artists who followed his path. In 1968, Graciela Carnevale, and make that event that you just mentioned, when she locked people who attended the gallery, created a scandal that made political implications. I mean, people were detained. It was a whole incredible display of power by the government related with this event. More and more, as Gabnice recognized, there was an attempt to, and I quote, "let the message or the context exist on its own without being trapped in material confines," end of the quote. There was here an attempt to downgrade the material, but, and I quote, "without any particular dedication to have it eliminated." Connected with this process of dematerialization, Kamnitzer retrospectively sees a process of erosion of information, the distance that exists between the conception of the work and its final result. In 1969, David Lamelas was born in 1946, partially analyzed the process described by Kamnitzer, and I quote Lamelas. "Once we have the idea, the next step is to consider the means required for its materialization. Automatically, everything tends to disregard this executive phase that exists between the idea and the finished work. All subsequent reasoning is aimed at concealing this intermediate step, therefore succeeding in producing a work fit for consumption. The result, work of art, is thus completed, static and tantamount to itself, an artistic object that will remain forever intact. This is invariably the case, even if those works change our compromised motion. But what is displayed is the result of an idea transformed into a concrete fact." End of the quote. As it was with this peripheral conceptualism, Lamela's concerns are with minimizing the process of erosion, not to hide it. There is a search for exposing everything to the viewer. By the way, this concern about erosion of information was highly politicized at the time. You're in a dictatorship that hide facts that, you know, is very much in the process of eliminating information and people in the process. And since Argentina was very much under the dictatorship, declared that pyramidism didn't exist. And this, I'm not joking about that. I mean, it was, you could end up in jail, you know, just to mention the name of Perón. It was like this part of the history had never existed. So this process of erasure was very much what the artists want to enhance. At the same time, he said that in doing it, they were risking themselves. So the revealing of hidden meaning and the need to show what was missing was highly important in the context of radical politics at this time. Conceptualism resonates with those artists influenced by the Cuban Revolution and theology of liberation because its intrinsic interest in developing, and I quote Kamnitzer, ways to send messages through no lost information systems. That's what is very important, and some of the pieces that Abanes analyzed follow that pattern. It is important to also mention here that by the time semiotics and structuralism were dominant among the intellectuals who not only, of course, painters, but in general, all intellectuals were influenced by these ideas. And they enhanced the interest in the following processes. One, the mediatization, the reduction of information loss. Second, contextualization, using context to give meaning. Third, reductionism, reducing the material. The mixing of ideas that is typical during the 60s led to an enormous number of writings and debates in which all these concepts were discussed. And because the political and artistic were so connected, the didactic function of art was enhanced. It is precisely this didacticism that explains the preeminence of the written word and an interest in the work of Saussure and Lévi-Strauss in the fields of semiotic and structuralism. And it's important to point out that the spread of these ideas happened before they became important in the United States. Thus, as Camisa reminds us, the interest in the text preceded minimalism, whereas in the United States, the reverse occurred, end of the quote. As a consequence, reading signs became part of minimalism. The contrary is evident in Latin America. In Brazil, for example, the concrete art was the consequence of concrete poetry. And as the singer Cayetano Veloso, if you read his book, Tropical Truth, describes. In Argentina, Jules Solar, a great friend of Borges, created a linguistic structure into which he wanted to merge all his art. End of quote. And minimalism would finally emerge in Argentina in 1967. The interest in language communication and the reveal of the hidden made art an important expression not only for artists, but also for radical guerrillas that started to emerge immediately after the Cuban Revolution all over Latin America. In the case of Uruguay, for example, that's coming to the country, the Tupamaros, which was the guerrilla, the name of the guerrilla group there, became well known for its use of media for propaganda. And these groups you will find, as Vanessa mentioned, guerrilla groups, an incredible interest in understanding how media works and the use of media to promote their cause. In the case of the Tupamaro, though, there was no interest in any aesthetics of art per se, but they needed to create an efficient and effective communication system. And in the case was not the creation of posters or visually rich material, but the use of mass media to display their acts. Camister mentioned specifically a famous Operation Pando in 1968, exactly a year after the killing of Che Guevara, in which 100 guerrillas participated and took over the city, the town of Pando with 20,000 inhabitants. Using as an excuse that there was a person who died in Argentina and had to be buried in Uruguay, they organized this burial and this ceremony for the person who had died, which of course was not true. So they organized and displayed 5 cars and a van as a part of a funeral. On its way, the procession stopped at several points, picked up relatives, which were all guerrilla members. They were all crying and very much, you know, acting up the event. And the coffin hid the weapons that they used for the operation. Once everybody was part and got together in the grieving group, the mission started. The guerrillas proceed to take over the police station, fire station, the telephone building, and all the banks in town. This operation, organized as a theatrical enterprise, was influential in other countries as well, the impact of the media and the theatralization of these political events. And in Argentina, and this is related to what just Vanessa presented, it seems that we organized this together, but swear to God, we did it. But in Argentina, a group of artists collective organized events to try to improve ways of artistic expression. The emergence of such events made clear that art and politics would influence each other in radical ways. The violent expression of the military government and that saw in its radicalization of youth a political and social threat only made the organization of sit-ins, for example, more popular. Graciela Carnevale, who belonged to the group of artists from Rosario, Rosario was a traditional, very much working class city that is a few hours north of Buenos Aires, and it had a strong proletarian tradition, wrote at this particular moment, and I said Carnevale. It was taken stock by a group of artists of their own conditions and proposing to modify them. This consciousness led to questioning the role of the artist in society, form, and content, and to consider a correspondence between art and life that forced a review of artistic practice from an ethical consciousness. Reality did not allow for doubt By the way, if you're familiar with any material produced in the 60s, for example, documentaries, they will find the same insistence about the existence of the real and removing the veil and very much accessing information that has been always hidden. In 1968, artists from Rosario and Buenos Aires organized the first national meeting of avant-garde to call for the creation of a new art with these characteristics. One, it could not lead to the creation of an avant-garde movement. Two, no shows in galleries and museums. Three, avoid addressing only the elite. And four, art needed to act and produce political actions. This happened at the same time that the dictatorship violently intervened in the province of Tucumán, as Vanessa mentioned, where poverty and social injustice was always invisible and unspoken. And with that attempted to stop the radicalization of politics. There was already a guerrilla group that tried to act in the area, so Tucumán became a very charged place politically. There were exhibits in Buenos Aires, as you mentioned, and Rosario, and these exhibits were not in art spaces, but were in the union places. And there was in film, pictures, installations, as you just saw when it's presented. The repression of the event was quite violent, and many artists decided to abandon the work as a consequence, in frustration about how to develop effective ways to make their ideas happen. Cristina del Carnevale said that, quote, continue meant to deepen the initiative path, to deepen ruptures and not accept political compromise, to deepen the risk, end of the quote. Nicolas Rosa, another participant, explained how Tucumán Arde and how this term event ended. He says, we went or tried to go from a somewhat musified art to a political engagement. We ultimately did something that we could call mass-mediated art, which meant we were opening, operating on the media, and we knew that the media imposed their own ideology because their own form of production organization, etc. End of the quote. Another artist, Renzi, explained that Tucumán Arde, Tucumán Birds, I quote, was the ultimate of the notion of conceptualism, after which one couldn't produce any conceptual work of any other kind of art. By some who participated in Tucumán Arte, Tucumán Birds, the event was considered disappointing, one that did not achieve its initial purpose, and some even rejected references to mainstream conceptualism. According to Leon Ferrari, those who connect Tucumán Arte and quote, with conceptual art, forget that this is a new avant-garde belonging to the same elite that the people of Tucumán Arde abandoned. Not only because they were serving or donating it, because they were making weapons for the enemy, but also because the elite contaminated their work because the language invented for and from the elite was useless for communicating with a new public that was sought. Tucumán Arde used art to make politics. The greatest part of conceptual art and of some expressions of contemporary political art uses politics as a subject matter to make art, end of the quote. And I want to refer that Tucumán Arde, Tucumán Birds, was the turning event that, I mean, only because of the repression that came after that and control that they have, the military dictatorship had over artistic spaces and so on, forced artists, some of them, for example, never produce art again. Some of them dedicated to music or some other way to expression. And it was a kind of limit exploration of the connection, the possible connection between conceptualism and politics. It took time to overcome the imposed silence that the artists choose as a form of expression after repression. They decided not to produce any art, disengage themselves as a way to express themselves. Eventually, some artists returned to the old path of gallery exhibits while the Tupamaros continued its theatrical operations for a few years more. As Caminitzer explains in analyzing this event, on balance, one can say that Latin American conceptualism emerged as an aesthetic more concerned with reality than with abstraction. This is something I always try to explain to my students when I touch on these things because they relate this very much to abstractionism. And in Latin America, it's quite the opposite. It came as an attempt to connect with the real. So it was not in any way an exploration of the possibilities of abstractionism. I continue with the quote. The fact that this distinctive characteristic has been overlooked by mainstream U.S. commentators on Latin America art denotes a narrowness of interpretation that has been applied to conceptualist strategies in general, and particularly to those that took effect on the periphery. And he calls for an analysis that Royal is promoting here, analysis of Latin American art, of course, as less derivative, but much more as an original, and it's conceptualist, an original conceptualist form that very much characterized the differences of artistic development in the 60s in Latin America with other parts of the world. Thank you very much.
Brescia is Associate Professor of Latin American Literature at USF. He earned his BA in Philosophy and Literature and his PhD in Hispanic Languages and Literatures from the University of California, Santa Barbara in the year 2000. He's a contributor to and co-editor of El Cuento Mexicano, Sor Juana y Viera, 300 años después, Borges Múltiple, Cuentos y Ensayos de Cuentistas, and El Ojo en el Caleidoscopio, Las Colecciones de Textos Integrados en la Literatura Latinoamericana. Those are all magazines, anthologies. He has published articles, essays, book and film reviews, interviews and translations in books and journals from Argentina, Canada, Denmark, France, Germany, Great Britain, Italy, Mexico, Norway, Puerto Rico, Spain, the United States, and Uruguay. His areas of teaching and research are history and theory of Latin American short fiction, genre studies, fantastic and science fiction, detective fiction, and 20th and 21st centuries Mexican and Southern Cone literatures and cultural histories, among others. He is the recipient of the 2010 Jamie Bishop Memorial Award for an essay not in English, awarded by the International Association for the Fantastic and the Arts. Pablo.
Hello, everybody. Thanks to Noel for the kind introduction. For you, thank you for being here on Friday morning. I guess a few disclaimers are in order. First, I knew little about conceptualism before this event, and I'd like to thank both Noel for inviting me and Adriana for encouraging me to present, although I'm not sure that thank is the right verb, but well, let's skip that. And secondly, as it is well known, the relationship between the visual arts and literature is a slippery one. And thirdly, my take on the topic will come from the vantage point of a literary critic. So having said that, thank you again for being here on the panel, I think I can say a few words about Borges and the topic, conceptualism, and I hope to learn about this topic from the panel. I already have done that. You'll see that our path will cross with Adriana, Adriana's talk in several different ways. The spring 2011 issue of Bomb magazine, just last semester, Bomb magazine is an important magazine for literature here in the States, presents an interview with Luis Kamnitzer, as Adriana said, a world-renowned artist, was born in Germany, grew up in Uruguay, and has been living in the States in New York for the past 4 years. So if you want a short, nice introduction to Kamnitzer, maybe you can read the interview that's online. He put together the famed exhibition Global Conceptualisms, Points of Origin, 1950s to 1980s, in 1999, and authored Conceptualism in Latin American Art, Didactics of Liberation. So after reading the interview, you can go to the book that Noel has there. So that's his book. So if you're interested in the topic, that's what maybe you could start. So in the interview, Kamnitzer states, "I don't like what usually is referred to as political art, because it mainly expresses the views of the artist, something that nobody really cares about or should care about. Those views are only biographical material. The real aim of political art should be to convert those who think differently. You can only do this if you lead the viewer to reach his or her own conclusions on the matter, and if these ultimately agree with your own views. Art has to be highly manipulative or didactic in the best sense, to set the stage for viewers to reach the insight that you want them to reach, in the belief that it all happened naturally and without coercion. That's wonderful. I try to follow this process in all of my pieces. If sometimes something happens that you call poetic, it is a byproduct that I may feel is needed. Like nice wrapping paper. It's the same with a work's beauty. In this regard, I see both Borges and Magritte more as creators of methods than as presenters of interesting topics. Their methods influence me. So I guess it's important to pay attention to the end of this citation. Kamnitzer emphasizes what he takes to be the Borgesian method. In looking at the relationship between Borges and conceptualism, we're interested then in how Borges was read by other artists, and not only visual artists. Kamnitzer, for instance, makes the facile mistake in his book of perpetuating the myth of an apolitical Borges. He says that the Argentine writer was, and I quote him, disconnected from the process of politicization that surrounded him. Moreover, he was famous for his conservative and sometimes reactionary stances, a point highly debatable. However, for Kamnitzer, his method is what matters. I quote him again, Borges provides a way of seeing and speculating, a kind of methodology of thought that was extremely important. He exemplified a project of pulling together a coherent field of inquiry from disciplines of knowledge, memory and fantasy, and from real and invented nostalgia, end quote. So I guess a potentially engaging intellectual exercise would be to compare and contrast this view, Kamnitzer's, with reactions from the literary field about Borges' legacy. So I'll just take two. The first one reads as follows. The final meaning of Borges' prose, without which I might add there simply would not be a new Latin American novel, is to attest, first and foremost, that Latin America lacks a language, and consequently must create it. To do that, Borges mixes all genres, rescues all traditions, kills all bad habits, and creates a new rigorous order from which irony, humor, and play arise, yes, but also a profound revolution that equates freedom with imagination, end quote. This is from Mexican writer Carlos Fuentes. The second one, the second take on Borges reads, I am quite aware of how ephemeral literary assessments may prove, but in Borges' case, I do not consider it rash to acclaim him as the most important thing to happen to imaginative writing in the Spanish language in modern times, and as one of the most memorable artists of our age. This is Peruvian writer Mario Vargas Llosa. So these two writers, one of them Latin America's most recent literary Nobel laureate, right, last year, are among the most well-known representatives of the boom, a period in Latin American literary history from 1960 to 1970, roughly, in which modernism reaches the shores of the New World, producing highly original narrative works which were widely translated. This had happened in poetry, but not in narrative until the 60s in Latin America. So this, and Borges is widely considered to be a precursor to the bomb, right? He's not detonated the bomb. This period also coincides with the emergence of Latin American conceptualism, which interrogated the nature of art and its role in the political arena and evolved into an epistemological project designed as a critique and the construction of discourses. So two basic tenets stand out from what Kamnitzer said, from what Fuentes said, or from Vargas Llosa said, their take on Borges, the idea of a revolutionary method and the idea of imagination. So I guess we have to ask, so who is this Borges and what is this method, right? So Borges was born in 1899. When he was young, he liked to say that he was born in 1900s, so he's born with a century. He was a central figure for world literature and criticism in the 20th century. He was born in Buenos Aires. He spent his school years first in that city and then between 1914 and 1918 in Geneva, Switzerland, where he reads Schopenhauer, Chesterton, Stevenson, and Kafka, all central to his own aesthetic. His brief stay in Spain familiarizes him with the components of Ultraismo, one of the avant-garde schools. And back in Buenos Aires in 1921, he co-founds several literary magazines and publishes his first book of poems and literary criticism. I think it's very, very important to stress that Borges was first a critic and then a writer of fiction. And this is very important for his own literature. In 1935, he publishes his first attempt at storytelling, with a universal history of infamy. His most significant work, however, is comprised of two volumes of short stories, Ficciones, or Fictions, from 1944, and The Aleph, from 1949. He's translated in Europe in the 50s, and the United States in the 60s, and rapidly becomes the darling of critics such as Gerard Genet, Michel Foucault, Umberto Eco, and writers such as John Barth and John Updike, for example, in the States. Meanwhile, Borges keeps writing an enormous amount of criticism. He also begins to give conferences and teach at universities. By this time, by the 60s, he's already blind. It's a famous anecdote that, you know, he always wanted to be a director of the library, and by the time he becomes the director of the library, he's blind and can't read. He has a famous poem about this, about the irony of God, right? Giving him the books and the night. In 1956, then, he's named director of the Argentina National Library. In the 60s, he returns to poetry, and in the 70s, he publishes two new books of stories, Rory's Report from 1970 and The Book of Sun from 1975. So for the purposes of this presentation, we need to take a look at a particular moment in Latin American literary historiography. The 19th century, especially at the end, saw social, political, and literary forces, romantic literature, and the realist naturalist novel shape national cultural identities, establishing what Doris Sommer has called foundational fictions. By the beginning of the 20th century, a new paradigm, in part derived from the realist naturalist paradigm, called regional or telluric fiction, strongly linking geographical space to national identity, began its hegemonic hold on literary output. But starting around the mid-30s and continuing for the next two decades, Borges begins a process similar to what Gregory Ulmer finds as a theoretical agreement between Borges' aesthetics and conceptualism. Quote Ulmer, "The artist's impersonal intention to produce art, a grammar of mechanical forms, and the audience's individualizing creative perception," end quote. So Borges' unprecedented intervention in the Argentine literary field, reviewing, critiquing, anthologizing, writing poetry and fiction, becomes not only a poetics, but a politics of the literary. Taking from T.S. Eliot, he writes a very important essay called The Argentine Writer and Tradition, where he supports a radical position at the time. The national literary tradition for Argentina, and one could argue for Latin America, is the universe. And because of Argentina's peripheral location, writers can intervene in the tradition by being irreverent with it. In his book, Kamnitzer sees it well, quote, "Our peripheral vision in Latin America consisted of a triple burden. We knew the culture of the centers, we knew the reality of the periphery, and felt the unevenness and the irony of living in both," end quote. So what allowed Borges to perform such intervention? Here, there's, you know, 1,000 elements that influence his work, but I would venture to suggest that there are two things that are very important. Borges' work with genres, and he was especially fond of the fantastic and of the detective fiction. So both the fantastic and detective fiction became his preferred agency to challenge canonical modes of reading and writing because of their intrinsic interest in being artificial. Borges' first book was called Artifice, like, you know, pointing out that it was not reality. And that's having to do more with ideas and less with a mimetic impulse. So he followed his literary and philosophical interests and creates a new genre, Ficciones, that combines the fantastic, the detective story, the persuasive structure of the critical essay, the reviewing of imaginary books, and an intertextual system of citations. So I'll just give you a rundown of some of the things he does with this mix. So for example, in a very important short story called Tulon Ukbar or Mistertius, he tells of the finding of an encyclopedia that describes an imaginary planet where idealism is real. So then later in the story, objects from the fictitious planet appear in the real world and begin to invade it. In another very famous story is in Pierre Menard, author of the Quixote. This is an ironic take on the possibility of writing Cervantes' masterpiece in the 20th century. The Circular Ruins, meanwhile, juxtaposes dream and reality, where the man who wants to dream another discover he himself is a dream. The South is a masterpiece of the fantastic in which readers cannot seem to determine the protagonist, Juan Dalman, is dreaming his death or not. And the Library of Babel imagines the universe as a library of hexagonal galleries, or maybe in a Malarmian fashion, as a book. In the detective story, Death on the Compass, we encounter several of the Borgesian motifs, the enigma that Detective Lorne Roth must solve, the symmetrical structure, four letters, four murders, and the space of the labyrinth. And the elasticity of the concept of time was one of Borges's favorite topics. Besides writing an essay with the paradoxical title, A New Refutation of Time, I'm sure philosophers would have a party with that title. Time is central to, for example, an examination of the work of Herbert Quain, where Quain's novel, April March, postulates a regressive past. It's also important time in a story called The End, where Borges rewrites the literary past, modifying the ending of the most important character in Argentina's literature, Martin Fierro. And time is also central to The Secret Miracle, a story whose protagonist, Jaramil Hladik, is about to be killed by a firing squad and asks God a year to complete his drama piece. In the physical world time, the temps, time stops for 2 minutes, but in the mind of Hladik, the Dure, a year goes by and he can complete his work. Meanwhile, Funes de Memorios, a story Borges characterized as an extended metaphor about insomnia, introduces Funes, an Uruguayan who can remember everything, but cannot discern among his memories. So he says, "My memory, sir, is like a garbage heap." And another piece, The Garden of Forking Paths, presents within the enigma frame preferred by Borges in his detective stories, the idea of a novel, also called The Garden of Forking Paths, which contains at the same time all possible outcomes, quote, bifurcating towards innumerable futures, end quote. So that's a taste of what he does in his fiction. So in Borges's fictions, the referent ceases to be what is perceived to be reality, and language itself becomes the frame of reference. This strongly links his poetics to the basic tenet of conceptual art, which according to Ulmer proclaims that art has nothing to do with formal objects. Instead, ideas and concepts alone are art, end quote. So in Borges's method, as exemplified in the tales we have commented on before, narration is primarily a linguistic fact and therefore should be associated to thinking. This in turn makes Borgesian writing, in the words of Julio Ortega, a critical writing. And here's where we go back to the way Borges has been read. We talked about how these writers and Kamitzer pointed out to his imaginative quality, right? Imagination. This is in part because Borges transformed into narrative material his philosophical and literary interest. He created a worldwide web of interrelated themes and motifs: literature, death, time, identity, Borges, the labyrinth, the mirror, the library, the double, the book, Borges. His fictions and essays, there's a few that are very important, Kafka and his precursors, the narrative, art, and magic. He will develop his poetics based on two main statements. Number one, narration must be a rigorous scheme of attentions, echoes, and affinities. And narration, therefore, is better fitted to the adventure novel than what he calls the psychological novel. And number two, the book must be considered as a fountain of innumerable relationships for the reader, who engages in a secret commerce that becomes what Borges calls the aesthetic event. In the same vein, writers, those very special readers, create their precursors, and thus modify not only the literary future, but also the literary past. So Borges was fond to say that, Kafka was an influence on Zeno, right, instead of the other way around. In addition, Borges proposes a national literature that should not be overtly so, since, as he claims, in the Quran we don't find camels, and that is proof of its Arabic quality. From this selected marginality periphery, Borges represents the textualist approach of critics such as Richard Rorty or Jacques Derrida or Roland Barthes, weighing the idea of the book as an organic entity that supposedly reveals the truth about the world is replaced by the idea of a text that weaves different patterns and only takes itself to be an écriture that calls our attention to the process of signification. Kamitzer translates Borges' vision into the artistic sphere. Borges' early idea of conflating metaphors, for instance, made the fantastic turning art, what Kamitzer calls a fantastic turning art, possible. And furthermore, the merging of two images created a new product that, and I quote because this is important for Borges, this new product became as much a part of reality, artistic or otherwise, as the originating piece, end quote. So it is, it's not by chance, and I'm finishing up here, that we end up talking about Borges and originality. No? Ultimately, like any other great artist, Borges was searching for a language of his own. His was an encounter between a continent that, according to Fuentes, lacked a language and must therefore invent it, and a writer that envisioned in Tlon a world where all languages disappear, replaced by one where there are no nouns and the primary unit is not the verb, but the monosyllabic adjective. But in his fictions, the relationship to language is mediated most often than not by the figure of the reader. To him, the universe and his own self are like a woven text that holds an intricate secret code, and like the priest in one of his stories, The Writing of the God, who attempts to figure out a pattern in the jaguar's spotted skin in order to find out the name of God. So we, his readers, must try to decipher codes in order to find meaning, even though we might not be able to communicate the results. It's become commonplace to quote from Pierre Menard, author of the Quixote, to exemplify Borges' theory of reading, which anticipated reception aesthetics, postmodernism, postcolonial studies, and who knows what other literary trends, right? I'd like to end by quoting from a little known precursor to that story. There's a book that Borges renounced called The Idiom of the Argentines from 1928. And there we find an essay called Literary Pleasure. Here Borges, who is 28 years old, but has read like he was 90, talks about his early readings and says, I was a hospitable reader in those days, a polite explorer of the lives of others, and I accepted everything with providential and enthusiastic resignation. I believed everything, even errata and poor illustrations, end quote. But Borges, mind you, still 28, says in this essay, and today I've turned into a writer, a critic, and I must confess that I reread with the pleasure of remembering and that new readings do not enthrall me. So Borges, the critic, feels nostalgic about the time where he experienced the pure aesthetic pleasure of feelings, or feeling words and language come into being. But rereading also has its pleasures. At the end of the article, Borges performs a reading exercise when considering this Cervantes verse. In Spanish, it's Vive Dios que me espanta esta grandeza, which means, by God, this greatness terrifies me. He explained that in Cervantes' time, this was a common phrase, meaning roughly, how this device astonishes me. Read today, the expression, according to Borges, is firm and tidy in our eyes. And so he says, he concludes, time has sagely revised Cervantes' drafts. So as Borges says in a note on Bernard Shaw, one literature differs from another, prior or posterior, less because of the text than because of the way it is read. All the same, Ulmer says that in conceptualism, the true creator of art is not the artist's producer, but the percipient. And Kamnitzer finishes his interview by stating, given that art is not science, it is liable to be the target of multiple readings and projections. So the lasting work is one that is able to sustain the projection of new problems or new interpretations that are relevant at the time that the reading and projection take place. This reactivates the work no matter what the original intentions were, and makes it lasting. I don't believe in absolute and eternal values. I believe in this interpretative dialogue that keeps changing over time. The work in itself is relatively unimportant, regardless of the hype around its place in history and public relations. Who its maker was is also unimportant, and only of biographical interest. The relevance of the dialogue and how it may affect the present rather than how it has affected the past is what matters, says Kamnitzer. So Borges liked to quote, and that's what the title of my presentation. The title of my presentation was Art Happens. So Borges liked to quote the painter Jane Whistler when defining art. Art happens, says Whistler. Apparently, it is up to us readers and perceivers to determine exactly what happens. Thank you.
Today, last but not certainly not least, Cesar Cornejo, born in Lima, Peru in 1966. He lives and works in, get ready, Florida, Brooklyn, Peru, and the United Kingdom. He is assistant professor of art in the School of Art and Art History at USF. His work addresses socio-political issues with particular focus in his native Peru. and the way it translates into international context through the use of processes which he has incorporated through his architectural background and his experience living and working in Japan, London, New York, and Peru. His work includes sculptures, installations, and alternative architectural models that redefine the relations between the individual and the built environment. Cornejo has received awards and residencies from institutions such as Creative Capital Foundation, New York Foundation for the Arts, Lower Manhattan Cultural Council, Center for Book Arts, in New York, Sculpture Space, British Council, Henry Moore Institute, and the Ministry of Education of Japan, among others. He graduated from architecture in Lima and then was awarded MA and PhD degrees in sculpture from the Tokyo National University of Fine Arts and Music. Okay. Thank you. Now, I think your first slide somehow got, that's your first slide. So just, you know.
Thank you very much tomorrow for the invitation to this panel, to my colleague panelists, and to you for attending today. And it's great to have you here. When I'm asked or invited to talk about artists, it's always an effort because it means that I have to somehow get into that person's skin. Interpret the work, not as the actual person, but somehow as a third party, not me necessarily, not either the artist, but somewhere in between. And that effort of separating from my, let's say, artistic, creative part has been really exciting in case of David, the work of David Lamelas, because in that journey you get transformed. And somehow I felt that through this journey of studying the work of David Lamelas, I have been transformed somehow, and also have understood other things, new things about my work that I wasn't aware of before I studied his artist. And I think there are some very big topics in this panel that require very deep analysis and clarification. And I'm not sure either if I can even grasp the answers to these problems. But still, I think it's important that we present them. And some of them have already been mentioned by my colleague panelists. And I would like just to present them or restate them and somehow try to figure out, work on the answers along this presentation. Last year I was invited to be part of a panel which tried to redefine Latin American art at the CAA conference in New York. And the big conclusion after this panel was that it wasn't anymore about being Latin American to be a Latin American artist. By the way, last year there was a record number of Latin American art presentations at the CAA conference in New York. There were five presentations of Latin American art. They had never been that large number, so that I think is a good symptom. And it's great that we're having it here today at USF. And going back to this subject of identity and what it means to be a Latin American artist, I'd like to put two examples that somehow document this problem. On one hand, we have an artist like Gabriel Orozco, who tries to not be seen as a Mexican artist or Latin American artist. He tries to break his link with his country as much as possible, and tries to be seen as an artist alone, just an international artist whose ideas should be seen as such, not as from where he comes from. And then we have an artist like Francis Alice, who is originally from Belgium and moves to Mexico to create this amazing body of work based on his experience there. And he's seen by many as a Latin American artist, even though he's born in Belgium. And I think those two artists somehow are important for us to understand what David Lamelas was doing already long before their time. And on the other hand, also we have another problem that we think should be aware of. When we say Latin American art, we tend to group a very complex reality which includes countries as different as Argentina, Brazil, Cuba, Venezuela, Colombia, Peru, etc., in one large package. And those who come from Latin America, and many of you know, that each of those countries are extremely different. We have extremely different cultures, extremely different traditions, different political realities, sociopolitical realities. And therefore, we can be outsiders within Latin America ourselves. We, as I'm as a Peruvian, can be an outsider in Argentina or in Venezuela or Brazil. And that's perfectly normal. And I think that as well relates very much to the work of David Lamelas in the terms of he has been constantly an outsider and has been permanently trying to stay that way by his permanent change of places to produce his work. On the other hand, I think there is another element that has been already mentioned as well that goes along all the work, in this case of David Lamelas, that has as well been treated as material and has been transformed to his, let's say, between commas, Latin American origin. And that's an element of time. He has made time the essence of his work. And I would like to establish some parallels here, for instance, with an artist like Un Kawara. He's a Japanese artist, a conceptual artist, who uses time as well as his material, but the way that Un Kawara does it is by individualizing or communicating his individual experience of time and presenting it. Like he has recordings of him counting the paintings he makes every day are statements of his personal experience of that time that he has lived. But in the case of David Lamelas, the time is a collective experience. It's not only his own experience of time, but it's a collective, it's a group experience. And therefore, he tries to get people involved in that experience and be this at the center. As it was mentioned just by Pablo, there is this necessity of having the audience at the center of the work. And I think that that's very visible in the way that David Lamelas interprets time, uses time in his work. I think that as well, and this is where my, let's say, artist persona will somehow filter this information is that I think as well there's an element of a structure that has to do with architecture that has to do a lot with the work that David Lamelas produces. And that's something that as well characterizes many contemporary artists in Latin America. Many contemporary artists, not certainly the case of David Lamelas, but he does it through his work anyway. Many contemporary artists in Latin America have architectural backgrounds. They studied architecture first, and then they became artists. That's more common in Latin America than in your countries. And that's interesting as well, the case of Francis Alís, who was an architect, and he became an artist when he went to Mexico. So that makes him Latin America, maybe that's it. I would like to also establish that relationship because in many of the works of David Lamelas, I'd like to point out that there is definitely a structure, an architectural structure that is somehow translated into the work itself. Not necessarily in the most obvious way, but there is, I think, this sense of a very abstract presence of architecture in the most broadest perception, in an immaterial way almost. The architectural, not the architecture of walls and roofs, but the architecture of relations, and the architecture of invisible relations that happen in the space, and which is before the building. And that's what I think is more relevant in terms of understanding of space and understanding of architecture itself, an understanding of the phenomenon of space. And that's, I think, what he does, that's what he has achieved with his work, and relation between space and time. And in that sense, I think that having somehow presented those large subjects, I'd like to now focus a little bit on some of the works that he has made along the years that document this. This sculpture, I mean, that's him from the sculpture, which was made for MoLA, Museum of American Art in Buenos Aires, is a mirror. And when he was invited to produce this public art piece, he thought about documenting time, but he didn't think that the camera was the best way of doing it because recording wasn't enough. And he thought that it was better to capture time as movement. So what he meant by that, camera also captures time and its movement. But basically what, and then we go back to this topic of how he makes of time a collective experience rather than an individual one. He was trying to not only document time, but make people aware of it. People who would pass in front of this sculpture became part of the piece. They became aware of their presence and their movement in that space. And they became part of the architecture, that somehow became aware of the architecture that surrounded that space. In that sense, this piece has been compared to another piece that Anish Kapoor, the famous British Indian sculptor, made for the Rockefeller Center in New York, where he had made a mirror as well, and but this mirror was reflecting the sky on the floor. And Lamela's is rather than trying to create an effect that has basically a aesthetic result, he's trying to raise awareness of the media and the architectural, in this case, surrounding. So I think that has some proofs, brings some evidence of some of these ideas that somehow I have been trying, I tried to delineate at the beginning. Other parallels that I'd like to also establish is, for instance, in this case, there is a the presence of the TV monitors which where no dome channel or no video is being featured, which Vanessa explained at the beginning. But I'd like to also focus on the architectural, again, the architectural element in this work, which in one sense is very obvious through the design, let's say, of the space and the presence of these objects, which reminds us as well of another artist, Alfredo Jarre, who again is someone who also studied architecture before being an artist, but then there's another layer, and that's something I think I always I find really exciting about Lamela's work. It's never really what you first perceive what the work is about. There's another layer, and to me there's all this reflection about this object that repeats, that doesn't have a content apparently, that then you go back to the object and you find out that it's an object itself, in itself. And then you think about the whole space, and you think about all this network of aura spaces, as Vanessa explained at the beginning, where he was not only commenting about the piece for contemporary art, but about the institutions that were presenting the works. And so this is something that Lamelas, I think, is very good at. And I, in an interview, he had said that something that he didn't like about contemporary art, or sorry, conceptual minimalism produced in America and in Europe, was that once a work was made and you saw it one time, you could see it, you didn't need to see it around. You just had enough information to understand the work and you could walk away and you didn't have to experience it again from any other angle. And he said that he was trying to reconstruct that experience and basically he was going back to literature. He was trying to make his work as a book where you had you read one page at a time and then you move to the next page and then continue reading and you accumulate information and then you, with that information you arrive to the end. And so his work is structured somehow as a book instead of, let's say, a video or installation. So that as well, I think, is an element that has some parallels with architecture in terms of architecture being an intertextual reality, where the city itself can be seen as a book, where you read buildings, where you read streets, you read the neighborhoods, and you create relations among them. And I think that this piece somehow does that clearly, and if you see the videos of Lamelas, for instance, pouring milk in a glass, it's online, you can find it easily, you'll see that he, beyond pouring milk on a glass and as a gesture, he goes beyond transforming that same event many times. So until you have watched a whole number of variations, you don't have an idea really of what the work is about. And so I think that sequence, that number of experiences that he presents in the work makes his work, even though he uses all the language and the techniques and ideas from conceptual art, conceptual minimalism, he does transform them and make them poetic. He makes them poetic, and I guess, and I think, that somehow originated in his Latin American origin. In this piece as well, where he was portraying a rock star, he did, there's a lot, because he, but he, some of the things that he does as well that represents this intersexuality or these different readings of a piece, happens along a very long period of time as well. Sometimes he will revisit a work and recreate it and then make a comment on the first work in this one. And you will need to know both to be able to understand the body of work. And that, as well, I think connects with this idea of poetry and intertextuality and literature and architecture. And this is him at 60, I believe, and here in this billboard, featuring a rock star as today, he comments as well, as a joke almost, rock stars today somehow every time look younger and younger instead of looking older. So he was portraying that phenomenon, and somehow you see how this work refers to this early other body of work that I show, and this has to be the first work now is not anymore alone. It has to be seen in relation to this one, and so the life of the artist as well becomes the work, and that is an idea that Lamelas was already exploring in late 60s, 70s. And today has become the center of discussions in art. I mean, recently Creative Time organized a series of lectures called Life as Form and in New York. And basically, it was something that Dormelas was already doing back in the 60s, 70s. And therefore, his relevance can be seen as beyond what is conceived as, let's say, traditionally Latin American art. And in works of this kind, even though they are more traditional in comparison to the ones I showed before, there's still a strong need or urge to break the structures of what was traditional, let's say, sculpture at the time. These works were made with formica, for instance, which was material used for kitchens mostly in the 70s, and referred to the Empire State Building, relation to the Cubans, Empire State Building is the title. And in an interview also, he comments how his work, when he first moved to London, was very influenced by the institution where he studied. And I think that also is an element that he may have used in his, may have limited somehow, but also he used in his own benefit. And I think that that's something that he may have also encouraged him to keep moving constantly along his life. Just not being framed neither by, in this case when he went to London, institutions I see relation here with the work of Philip King, for instance, one of his professors were professors, so he moved to St. Martin's in England to study St. Martin's. But he has, I think, along the time of his career, fought against being inscribed in a particular structure that will force him to produce a specific kind of work. And I think that this struggle is visible somehow between the relation of these works and the works that I showed before. And for instance, this work as well, when I talked about the artist's life as the work itself, portrays his friends in England. And this is it's just that, it's the life of the artist, who he was hanging out with, who were his friends. And at the same time, it becomes a record of the time he lived, of a particular period of time, and the relations that he developed with these people. I think that Eliozik is one of them there. You already know this piece, I think this is when it was presented at PS1. The relations between the architecture, the person, the space, the time, the idea of being an outsider within your own persona somehow. Because when, I don't know if you had experience of being in this piece when it was presented here at Cannes, I certainly did. Well, and it was a very hard thing to do, actually, to stand under that light, force you to get out somehow of your persona or seeing yourself from the outside almost. And I think that that's with the minimal element of the light and the camera in front of you, I think that that was a very strong piece to go through. And I think that that's, in a way, the essence of what he expects the viewer to go through in the process of his work. I'm going a bit slow. I was asked by Noel to show a little bit about what I do. As part of this, I'll be happy to share some images. It's not going to be very long, don't worry. I'm just glad to do it in relation to what Lamelas does, because, as I said at the beginning, studying the work of Lamelas has forced me to understand my work also in a different way. And this is a work I am producing currently in Miami, so in Puno, Peru, where I'm developing a museum using low-income houses in low-income areas of this city, which is the second poorest city in the country. And basically what I'm doing is I'm offering to build for free spaces and houses, and in exchange the owners let me exhibit art. And after the exhibitions had finished, they inhabit the spaces and live in the spaces and become their own houses, their own homes. So they benefit from this space. I'm just going to walk here. When I lived in Peru, I probably would have never thought about making this kind of project. I mean, I was an architect in Peru, and then I had a strong interest in social work, and I did actually some stuff. But traveling to Japan, spending 7 years there, and then England, and then New York, somehow helped me to become that what Lamelas talks about, being an outsider. And so I didn't become an outsider. Of course, I was an outsider in all those places I lived, but I also became an outsider in my own country. Right? Because whenever I went to Peru, it wasn't the same. I was not able to see the country as I used to when I lived there. And then even more in Puno. Puno is in mountains, and something, as I said before, when you're a Latin American, you can be an outsider in other countries in Latin America, but you can also be an outsider in your own country. Because Peru, for instance, is divided by geography and tradition and cultures in three, at least, or at least three big areas, and jungle, the mountains, and the coast. And so this is in the mountains, totally different culture to mine. I am from the coast. And there are two ethnic groups there, Quechua and Aymara, who are the main groups there. And so I am an outsider when I go there now. And that somehow, I think, has influenced a lot of the work I have produced with them, or I'm producing with them. But also, what I reflect about, and I was aware of this from the beginning, that I was an outsider, but I wasn't aware, necessarily, after actually seeing Lamelas, is that something that happened when I went to Japan is that I saw Japanese or Japanese culture in relation to Peru. It reminded me of Peru, or the mountains of Peru, because somehow the cosmovision that they have in Japan is very similar to the cosmovision of the people in the mountains of Peru. But then when I go now, I think about them as Japanese almost. So it's not anymore the memory of Peru, it's a memory of Japan through my memory of Peru when I was in Japan. So it gets more complicated. And so I think that's something I wasn't aware before, actually working or researching about David Lamelas. And then I'm just gonna show a project we did in February for this project, which was based on this, which is a local technique to build in Peru. They use eucalyptus, it's a very cheap way of building and building structures for pouring concrete. And basically what I did was I hired people to create this kind of structure. And instead of having it just raw, we folded it with aluminum leaf. So we created this kind of Guggenheim Museum look with a scaffolding. And then this is an image. And then we just used aluminum leaf from kitchen. And I invited an artist who is another interesting element also that comes from, I think, this relation with Lamelas. I invited an artist who is originally from Houston, but whose parents are from Bolivia, who does this kind of work, which is, I think, amazing in both community and site-specific. And I invited her to come. She was coming to Peru with her boyfriend, who is from Holland, who is a photographer. And I invited both to come and do something for the project. So they did this with a scarf that they found in the local market. And basically, it's a poem from the Aymara tradition, which says, I was you and I never knew it. And it was there, hung on this structure. And she made a performance there, which has elements of local culture that through the eyes of someone who, as I said, is not from there. She's from Houston. She can speak Spanish, but she doesn't speak it 100% well. And they did this on the Uros Islands, where also somehow explore the relation with the local culture. And then from there, I just showing this, which is something that's coming up. This is going to be in Miami Basel now in December, their positions. And this is the Puno Mocha project. It's going to be presented by the gallery Lucia La Puente. I'm actually currently working on it now in my studio here. And there's another element that comes from, I think, Lamela's study and in general Latin American artwork, that sometimes we think, oh, that's very conceptual, Latin American art, yeah, it's wonderful. But the truth is that sometimes in Latin America, we have to struggle a lot with finding the resources to produce the work. And sometimes it's just that originates the work. Like when I made this project for the museum in Puno, I never thought about it as a conceptual piece. I thought there's a problem, and I'm an artist. What can I do about it, right? And I didn't know about other projects that had happened certainly in that area before, but it was just a response to that real problem. And same here, like for instance, they asked me, make this for the booth. We want this, this installation. So I made a Guggenheim, because I love the museums, the way they work in terms of image. And I made this kind of comment on the Guggenheim and how it would work in Puno, and making an ironic real comment about museums in shanty towns, et cetera. And so the gallery would not pay for the production. They were really difficult about, they said they would, but at the end they were really putting a lot of pressure on that. And then I came up with an idea that I think is probably a lot better than this. And so I'm still gonna do this, but instead of using aluminum, as I was initially thinking, having really polished like the Guggenheim Museum is, I'm gonna use galvanized sheets, corrugated sheets, which I think is a lot better, because that is what they use in shanty towns. That's the cheapest materials you can use for aluminum. And that's how things happen. I mean, that's the real reason why I'm using it. It's not because I thought about it at the beginning, oh, it's great to have this material that makes reference to Latin America, et cetera. No, it was because there was a crisis in terms of budget. There is no money to make it this way. Okay, what more way can we do it? And I think that's something that we are somehow used in Latin America. Okay, we cannot do things right, but we cannot do them as we want initially. What other solution can we find? And there's where I think the work somehow happens, and many times comes from there. I would just like to finish with a brief quote from Borges, actually, which somehow I think, two quotes. One is from Borges and the other one is from Lamela himself. One is, quote, time is the substance from which I am made. Time is a river which carries me along, but I am a river, I am the river. It is a tiger that devours me, but I am the tiger. It is a fire that consumes me, but I am the fire, unquote. That's Jorge Luis Borges. And then going back to the subject of the outsider, Lamelas is asked in an interview by his interviewer, Faye Nicholson, his interviewer. He's asking him, in reading about your work, in articles and reviews, it seems that many people struggle to place your practice. In his article for the September-October edition of Frieze in 1997, Stuart Morgan said, Lamela's art must be considered as that of a permanent outsider because he falls between structures, movements, and nationality. Do you agree with this statement? And Lamela's responded, no, I don't agree with the idea of the outside, because when you are an outside, when you are outside, you are inside of that outside. But I do like the idea of playing with the inside and the outside. Maybe it is to do with the fact that I have always lived in different countries. I have always felt like an outsider, even as a child. But it's not because I'm in England, Italy, or Argentina. I felt like an outsider even in Argentina. I have always been out of the norm, between parentheses, let's put that away. For example, as a very young kid, most of the kids played football and I didn't. I loved to go to museums or concerts, so I was always outside of my group. It's part of who am I. Thank you very much.